we understand these are very new developments. The girls are still en route to Maiduguri, which is the state capital of Borno State, to be received there by the state governor and then transferred to the custody of the Directorate of Social Services, from which point then it'll begin the massive debriefing process, the psychological support, the meetings with their families. But it is just extraordinarily good news for the families, finally, after over 2.5 years. And bearing in mind, there are still around 200 girls still out there, still in Boko Haram custody. The fact that the International Committee of the Red Cross was able to do this, and the government is claiming for the time being that they were able to do this without giving in to any of the Boko Haram demands, which were a prisoner swap or a ransom, I think for the families, this is finally some real hope.
Why might have Boko Haram have agreed to do this if there wasn't anything in the deal for them, from what we can tell?
That is, of course, the question, and that's what we're trying to get some kind of sense of from the government. Why? Why now? We know that Boko Haram are in disarray. We know that they're divided. We know very much that their leadership feels incredibly beleaguered. So why hand over 21 of your most valuable assets right now? That's what we're going to keep digging into, Matt.
And what do we know about the remaining girls? How many are there? And
that, unfortunately, is pretty opaque, because one of the girls, up until this point, the only girl who had managed to escape Boko Haram custody since they were spirited off into the Sambisa forest, had said that some of the girls had died during the movement, during the government besiegement of the Sambisa forest area. So it's very difficult to get numbers. But that's what we're going to be looking to hear from those 21 girls. Okay.